Good afternoon, Tyagi sahab. Kindly unmute yourself, sir.
Good afternoon, director, sir. Please unmute, sir. Unmute yourself, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon. Welcome, you, sir. Khodke sahab has already.
So, Mahaveer sir, Ramkumar sir had joined or not yet?
Just give me a minute.
Yeah. Hello, Mahaveer ji. Madam,
yes sir,
check with the Ramkumar.
Yes sir, ye to, yeah, we can see Ramkumar sir had joined, I think.
Professor Ramkumar ji, can you hear us, sir? Mahaveer ji, can you see Ramkumar ji?
Sir, I'm talking on the phone for 5 minutes.
Okay.
So he will be joining at within 5 minutes, sir.
So in the meantime, we can start, madam, in a personal part.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. A warm afternoon to all present here and happy World's Mental Health Day to all. The august gathering of renowned academicians and dear students, Your Excellency and invited guest, I, Shahanaz Ayub, on behalf of Bundelkhand Institute of Engineering and Technology, and on my own behalf, I welcome all the dignitaries and participants to the 4th National Webinar on Transformations in Mechanical Engineering under the National Webinar Series on Transformations in Engineering and Technologies, started from 19th September, jointly organized by our institute, BIET Jhansi, and State Project Implementation Unit, Uttar Pradesh, under Knowledge Transfer Series. Before proceeding further, I request Honorable Director BIET Jhansi, Professor V.K. Tyagi sir, a multi-talented personality, to welcome the dignitaries and bless us with inaugural address on this wonderful occasion. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, madam. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
So, on behalf of Bundelkhand Institute of Engineering and Technology, I welcome the chief guest of today's webinar, Professor P.M. Khodke, Chief Project Advisor of TechUp 3, who had really transformed the technical education of the country and working day and night for the upliftment of the technical education of the country as a whole. I am associated with him since last 3.5 years when I joined as a director in this institution. And I found him so dedicated for the cause of the technical education, which is matchless and unparalleled. Whenever we had any problem, we directly interacted with him number of times, and he is a person who believes in solutions. Whether it is a cause of the accreditation of the institutions, whether it is the cause of the autonomy of the institution, he has always come forward to resolve the issues and has suggested the solutions for those problems. I really welcome him from the core of my heart. Welcome you, sir. Apart from this, I welcome the keynote speaker of today's webinar, Professor J. Ramkumar ji, who had my teacher also, on account of that I had attended certain short courses in IIT Kanpur. He may not knowing, but I know my teachers. Thank you, sir. For sparing your time to and become a part of this webinar, so that all the students and the participants who have joined this program will be benefited from your vast experience in the field of the mechanical engineering.
Thank you, sir.
As you all are aware that during this pandemic, this institution along with SPIU has taken an initiative to hold webinars on the relevant areas of the disciplines. And we started from chemical engineering, then we had with the computer science and engineering. And weekly we are doing these activities. Today it is the turn for the mechanical engineering. What transformation has taken place? The recent transformation has taken place in the area of mechanical engineering. So this is the turn of the mechanical engineering today. As I am not a person of mechanical engineering background, but definitely there are certain things which I would like to share at this juncture, that the mechanical engineering is a domain of engineering which is relevant, and it is relevant to almost all engineering disciplines. When you talk about the manufacturing, when you talk about the materials, when you talk about the products, the field of the mechanical engineering comes into the picture, whether it is related to products related to the civil engineering, whether it is related to the products related to the chemical engineering, electrical engineering, computer science engineering, hardware part, electronics engineering, whatsoever it may be. So the smart manufacturing, intelligent manufacturing, smart materials are the areas which are to be addressed in this gathering. I'm confident that Professor J. Ramkumar ji is an expert in the area, and he will share his experiences so that all the students and the participants will be benefited. Apart from this, it will be injustice if I do not welcome Professor Anil Kumar, who had always been very kind enough and has been associated with BIT during this pandemic and helping the BIT to organize such activities which are beneficial as a whole to the society and to all engineering disciplines. And his team, the team of SPIU, had always cooperated for organizing these activities. So this is becomes pertinent in today's scenario, that all the disciplines must work together and come out with the solutions for the society. Particularly, there are certain areas which I would like to stress upon at this juncture. Health sector has become a very important area in this pandemic. So what sort of research we are looking for? The focus of all researches must be on the healthcare, so that the benefit of the researches in the different domains can be passed on to the society, which is normally a culture in the US. In US, normally the researchers, the scientists, the professors work seamlessly, and number of the persons from the different domains join together to provide solution to the problems related to the society. Next sector may be energy sector. So we have to change our perspective of the research so that we can think of doing research on the lines which other countries, the advanced countries, are doing. So I'm confident that this webinar will definitely focus upon the relevant issues, relevant research areas which are taking place in the mechanical engineering, and all the participants will be benefited with the Khodke sir, his address, with the address of Dr. Anil Kumar ji, and with the address of our keynote speaker. I congratulate the organizers for holding the activities during this pandemic continuously in association with the SPIU Uttar Pradesh. With these words, I welcome one and all at this moment. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your motivation, guidance, and moral support. Your influence can never be erased. Thank you, sir, for being with us today. We are blessed to have a distinguished personality among us in this webinar, Dr. Anil Kumar, State Project Administrator, State Project Implementation Unit, Uttar Pradesh. Sir will deliver the opening remark. Over to you, sir.
Madam, thank you very much. Without taking much time, because already opening remark has been covered by Professor V.K. Tyagi, the director, sir. And we are with us two distinguished personality, Professor P.M. Khodke ji, our mentor, our guide, and our leader of TechUp 3 at the national level, and Professor J. Ramkumar ji, the distinguished expert of mechanical engineering from IIT Kanpur. So without spending time on me, I will request you to kindly request Professor P.M. Khodke ji to inaugurate the program and deliver his inaugural speech. Thank you very much, madam.
Thank you, sir. Leaders are by definition change makers, that is transformers. When you are called to lead, you are called to advance, move forward, and improve the situation. Yes, we have such a successful leader. The whole digital platform is vibrating and echoing his prominence. Chief guest of this webinar, Professor P.M. Khodke, sir, Central Project Advisor, NPIU. Sir, you hardly need any introduction. You have made all of us proud by your distinguished work as Central Project Advisor, NPIU. Professor Khodke, sir, is the Central Project Advisor of TechUp 3 project of World Bank project under Ministry of HRD, Government of India, for implementation of the project. A national level agency, namely NPIU, has been created, and Professor Khodke heads this body at national level. He was the principal Government College of Engineering, Karad, Maharashtra. Besides being principal, he has also served as a director, Maharashtra State Board of Technical Education, Mumbai, and also as a principal, Government College of Engineering, Amravati. He was also the Joint Director, Technical Education of Amravati Region. Professor Khodke, sir, is not only a mechanical engineering graduate and M.Tech and Ph.D. from VNIT Nagpur with a specialization in production engineering, but also possesses the degree of MBA, a man of good governance and inspiration to all of us. Professor Khodke is the recipient of Best Teacher Award from Government of Maharashtra in 2011. He is very active in professional societies and has an extensive experience of working on various universities' bodies. He has visited France, USA, Belgium, Turkey, Singapore, and Dubai for participating in various delegations and academic leadership programs. He is a man who looks forward to reform the whole engineering sector with the aid of technology. There are n number of achievements in his credit and has justified his role with efficiency. I request you, sir, to take this digital platform and fulfill our knowledge. We are honored to listen to your insightful speech as chief guest address. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, madam. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Thank you for nice introduction, and also for giving me an opportunity here to address you. No longer I am mechanical engineer since last 20 years. I am not at all connected with mechanical engineering, because the moment I entered into the administration, so administrator has to be unbiased. So you cannot just focus only on one discipline. But then multidisciplinary approach you one has to follow, which probably is the need of our today for, it is relevant to today's topic, that is transformation, right? So the director, honorable director of the institute, Bundelkhand Institute of Engineering and Technology, Professor Tyagi. My colleague from SPIU, Dr. Anil Kumar. The today's expert, from whom we have lot many expectations as far as the theme of the, you know, the today's webinar is concerned, Professor Jai Ramkumar ji. All my dear participants, my fellow colleagues from SPIU, and ladies and gentlemen. So basically, one should understand what is the meaning of transformation. So transformation is a change. And whenever there is change, change has got three faces. Normally, everybody has got, you know, coin has got two faces, but change has got three faces. And once you are over, once you pass over all these three phases, then probably the things work. These three phases are, first of all, opposition. One has to face a lot many opposition from everybody. Now, the moment you want to revise the curriculum, moment you want to, you know, introduce any reform in the institute, or in the teaching learning process, or in education, mechanical engineering, there is always opposition. Second, suppose that you don't buckle down to the opposition, second stage is insult. So people starts insulting you in front of you only, that you are useless, you are nonsense, this is, you know, very silly idea, so and so forth. So this is the second phase. And then third phase is, if you can pass over insult phase, if you can sustain this insult phase, then there is acceptance. So normally I have seen, while introducing any reform in education system, last so many years, maybe 20 years I'm in administration, so I know that, you know, whenever you want to introduce any reform, even in NPIU, under TechU also, we have introduced so many reforms. And I have gone through all these three phases. The first one was the opposition. Oh, this is nonsense idea. This is not going to work, etc., etc. Second one was insult. Oh, sir, you don't know what is that. You know, we have done in TechU 2 such and such thing, in TechU 1 such and such. So past history, you know, prevails. This is a kind of disbelief the people have got. And out of that, you know, you face this particular aspect, insult. But if you don't buckle down, so that is probably my habit, that I never sustain to any kind of pressure. I never buckle down. So then naturally it is acceptance. Now, as far as the transformation is concerned, transformation example is caterpillar, you know, turning into a butterfly. So that is a transformation from one mode to other mode. Today, just now I said, the transformation is nothing but, you know, the curriculum content. We normally discuss in outcome-based education also, there are three important, you know, aspects of any education system. What are your contents? How do you deliver it? And after delivery, how do you evaluate the students? So assessment. So these are the three important points, three important pillars of any education system. So if at all you want to have transformation, naturally you have to focus on content, content design, curriculum. AICT has come with you know, a very beautiful curriculum for every discipline, particularly for undergraduate. And that model curriculum was also circulated to all the institutions. Moment we issued the circular, you know, there was also one seminar in AICT. Lot many academicians, you know, raised the volume of their, you know, speech, you know, said that, you know, how can you make it compulsory? Our university system has got such and such system. We have, you know, what you say, Board of Studies. We have Faculty of Engineering and Technology. We have Management Council, Senate, so and so forth, you know. Yes, Academic Council, etc. So all these things, statutory authorities are there. But what these statutory authorities have been doing for a long time? Why the curriculum is not being changed? Why the recent practices are not adopted into the curriculum? And moment you do this, I just now said, you know, it is not restricted to mechanical engineering. I think Professor Tyagi also said that, you know, mechanical engineering has got applications in various areas. Say, for example, mechanical engineering has got areas, you know, application in, say, electrical engineering. So naturally, as a mechanical engineer, I should understand what is electrical engineering. What are the basic concepts? What is Kirchhoff's law, Ohm's law, that law, this law, induction motor, so and so, stepper motor, and all these things I should know. So little of these. So that is very, very essential. So nowadays, you know, future skills have come. Our mechanical engineers, you know, should be capable to find out the application of all these future skills. I mean, machine learning, artificial intelligence, cloud computing, data analytics, so on and so forth. So many future skills are there. These are the future skills. These are the present day requirements. So are we discussing in the class? You know, today, I'm very sorry. I don't want to criticize anybody. But as far as our faculty is concerned, they are always restricted to their subject domain. They are always restricted to their subject curriculum. While our students, if you see that they are coming with lot of general knowledge about the applications of all these things. So that is the difference. That gap has to be reduced. So our faculty has to be trained accordingly, and accordingly our syllabus should be modified, and they should be delivered very precisely, and the student should be evaluated. If only these three things, I will not go into heat transfer, I will not go into the design, machine design, I will not go into the production processes, because my specialization is in production process. Imprint, you know, you may be aware that MHRD has come with very specific, you know, this thing, imprint. That in imprint, there are n number of, you know, research areas. The areas which should be included in the curriculum should be also considered for curriculum. And in those thematic areas, there are many mechanical engineering areas. Just like, you know, advanced materials, Professor Tyagi has already spoken about. Smart materials, he said. You know, second one is nanotechnology. Third one is automation in manufacturing. Fourth one is flexible manufacturing. How can you bring you know, advances in the manufacturing process? How can you make this present manufacturing process effective? All these things are there. You know, see, as far as research is concerned, this is one aspect. But our mechanical engineer undergraduate students are not supposed to go into the details of all that kind of research. But then, you know, our students should understand whatever is being taught in the classroom, he should understand what are the various applications. If you tell him one application, second application should be told by the student only. And the teacher should also be capable enough to, you know, explain whether he is right or wrong. So that's why I just wanted to tell you that, you know, we should just focus on these three aspects. Pedagogy has to change a lot. You know, TechU project, what TechU project has done? TechU project has brought transformation in engineering education only. You know, even if you read this, our project implementation plan of TechU, even, see, forget about whether you are getting funds or not. Forget about whether you are getting accreditation or not. But whatever concepts and whatever reforms are enlisted in our project implementation unit, even if you implement those reforms, that will bring lot of, you know, transformation in not only mechanical engineering, but entire technical education. If you just have a look at, say, National Education Policy, New Education Policy 2020, you will see that many reforms which TechU has introduced, they are included there. You know, all co-curricular activities should become now curricular. So naturally, someone has to go and then naturally to accommodate these co-curricular activities. So employability skill training, what we say, you know, the, you know, soft skill training, all kinds of things are there included in the National Education Policy. So of course, our curriculum should be based on industry requirements, and industry requirements are these requirements. We should also go on checking what are the skill, what is the skill report of the, you know, National Skill Council. And based on that, we should just have some curriculum modification and accordingly training of the faculty, and accordingly teaching learning process should happen. I'm very much thankful to Professor Tyagi as well as Dr. Anil Kumar for giving me an opportunity. I'm, you know, I am always ready to, you know, participate and have interaction with so many people. So, you know, that's a great opportunity that this virtual mode of, you know, virtual mode of meeting and, you know, exchange of ideas has been, you know, created, and it is need of our today, because, you know, because of this epidemic, we cannot move from one place to other place. So naturally, and then this has become very punctual, right time we started at 3 o'clock. So, you know, you can start meeting right time now. Otherwise, you know, you just keep on waiting for some guests, some guests of honor and so many other people, participants are not there, etc., etc. So nothing of, you know, this kind of constraints nowadays. So thank you very much, and thank you for this Bundelkhand Institute of Engineering Technology for, you know, performing very good in TechU. We have about 6 months left, and we want to show that, you know, what we could not do. Particularly, we are going to focus now on digital learning. So please, please build up the, establish the infrastructure required for digital learning, empower your students, empower your faculty to use digital sources, like maybe, you know, a laptop, computational facilities, then Wi-Fi and, you know, internet capacity and all the this kind of thing. So hope that next 6 months also we will work together and collaborative. It is a collaborative approach only. With collaboration only, the project can be successful. Only SPA or CPA cannot make a project successful unless and otherwise there is equal contribution, more than that rather, from the institution side. And Professor Tyagi is helping us, assisting us in that direction. I wish good luck to all the participants and for the organizers for organizing this particular workshop. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It's our great pleasure that you have accepted our request to be here to bless us. Sir, we share with you that SPIU is continuously in the process of publishing their newsletter also. The fourth in the series is ready and we like to release it today. The fourth newsletter has the cover page is focusing on a tunnel for a metro rail in Calcutta, Hooghly River Underground Tunnel. So I request the CPA, Professor PM Khodke, to kindly digitally release this newsletter of SPIU, the fourth volume. Over to you, sir.
So I should declare only, right? Is there any button or something like that? No? Yeah. Yes. So I declare that this particular webinar is inaugurated, and this newsletter also, online release of quarterly newsletter of SPIU. It stands released today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Over to Sanna.
Yes, sir.
Madam.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Khodke, sir, we wholeheartedly thank you for your inspiring and encouraging words. We wish to express our gratitude to you, sir, for being with us on this event. Thank you very much for your thought-provoking address, which set a perfect platform for us on this important topic of today's webinar. And not only for this webinar, but for a further webinar series also, and to our environment of our institute also. Thank you so much, sir. Research is to see what everybody else has seen and to think what nobody else has thought. Yes, we have a great researcher and academician, our expert today, Professor J. Ramkumar from IIT Kanpur. Professor J. Ramkumar is currently a professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering and Design Program at IIT Kanpur. He joined as an assistant professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering in 2003. He earned his doctorate in Mechanical Engineering from IIT Madras. His research concentrated on micro and nano machining and finishing. He also has worked on tribology, coatings, and corrosion for both engineering and biomedical applications. Before joining IIT Kanpur, after his BTech from NIT Trichy, he joined Micro Bosch as a technical graduate trainee. He pursued his postdoctoral research in the area of intermetallic composites, machining, and fabrication at Osaka University, Japan. He is recipient of several fellowships such as Young Engineer Award of ISAC India and Gopal Das Bhandari Best Teacher Award by IIT Kanpur. Recently honored with Eminent Engineer Award from IEI India and Young Alumni Achiever Award from NIT Trichy and many more. He has published over 200 articles in the peer-reviewed international journals and has delivered over 80 lectures in the international conferences. His H index of 23, which endorses his high research productivity. His 5 patents are commercialized, total number of patents in his name being 69. He has procured a funding of over $4 million during his career at IIT Kanpur currently, and he is the project investigator of MedTech facility being developed in IIT Kanpur funded by BIREC DBT India. He is reviewer of over 25 technical journals from elsewhere, Blackwell Publishing Inc., Valley, Springer, Hindavi, Highwire, MRS India, INSA, ACS Publications, Institution of Civil Engineers, and American Society of Metals. Today, sir will deliver on transformations in mechanical engineering, focused mainly on futuristic manufacturing. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, madam. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah. Thank you, madam. Thank you so much for giving me a very nice introduction. At the outset, I am really privileged to have to share the stage, virtual stage, with PM Khodke, and then VK Tyagi ji, Director BIT, and other eminent personalities on the dais, of the dais, student front. Good evening to you all. It is really, really a very, very privileged moment for me, because I am sharing stage with such big personalities. In fact, whatever sir said, PM Khodke sir said, that is all true. Transformation is something which is coming up in a big way, and we are supposed to get in that transformation to reach sky heights. So under the able leadership of a personality like sir, our technical education is getting a big overhaul, and there are a lot of new skills which are getting honed into the system. So I wish their mission and our Prime Minister's vision, everything has to coincide, and we would see a bright future for the younger generations to come. With that few words, I would like to get into my talk. So I would like to focus my talk on futuristic manufacturing techniques. I have displayed here four key words. These four key words are very important. So if you look at these four key words, I said first is sustainable, socio, economic, and innovation. So these are the four words which you might know, but now integrating all these four words into the product, into the process, is very important. Forget your mechanical engineer, electrical engineer, or chemical engineer, or a civil engineer. Now engineering curriculum itself is slowly becoming boundaryless. So we are all engineers, that's it. So now the course restructuring is happening. So 50% of the courses only you do in your parental department, and 50% of the courses you will be other allied departmental courses as part of your curriculum. So let's get into the word first, sustainability. Sustainability is trying to produce a technology or a process or a product without disturbing Mother Earth. That is sustainable. In your school days, you have been taught reduce, reuse, recycle. Yes, we all studied. But did we implement? No. Why did we not implement? Because our objective was not sustainable. Our objective is to only reach a goal. So when we started keeping our objective of reaching the goal, we all said, hook or cook, reach the goal. So in this, while doing this process, we missed out many things in between. See, today we talk about so many processes which are available. For example, when you talk about laser, we talk about 20% efficiency. When we talk about EDM process, 25% efficiency. When we talk about an IC engine, 33% efficiency. See, we look at the efficiency, 33%, 34%, 35%, maybe 40%. But we have spent so much of energy, time, money in developing a vehicle, where the vehicle, we proudly say that we are happy with this vehicle, but the efficiency of this vehicle is only 30% or 40%. Look at the amount of byproduct and report the amount of pollutant it has released into the Mother Earth. Who is going to clean it? And when we as individuals, we have just borrowed it from the future generation, that the earth, we will try to protect it and give it to them safe. We have just borrowed them. So while doing this process, we forget the sustainability. Any process you develop, any product you develop, any technology you develop, any system you develop, keep first thing in mind is sustainability. Next thing is socio. Today, completely the school teaching has gone into online teaching. There are several benefits by going for online teaching. But you should understand, there is also a huge cultural impact which is creating on the children, on the student, by doing so. So now, what is this impact? How is this impact getting created? And how do we get out of this impact? Comes the next thing called socio. See, today we are talking about man-machine interface. Suppose, let us assume we have an online class. The online class mode says very clearly you cannot have a lecture more than 15 minutes. So 15 minutes of focused lecture and rest all should be connect to this 15 minutes of lecture you try to generate it. And that too, when you are trying to take a small kid less than class 5, they say the maximum concentration level is only 7 minutes. So a teacher has to teach within 7 minutes what he or she has to convey, and rest all 40 minutes will be going around the topic. So now you see the amount of social impact. People have become techno savvy. So moment people become techno savvy, they start using smartphones. They forget there is a world around them where it is netted with relations, with father, mother, love, all these things. So that is socio. The third one is economical. We are looking for products which are economical. That does not mean all the economical products are poor quality. No. We are looking for high quality products which are economical and which can find its existence or sustenance in the market. And the last one is innovation. Whatever solution we develop, it has to be human centric. So that means to say, you develop a solution, there has to be a person who takes the solution and goes further. So if you try to say, here is an interesting solution, but nobody comes and picks that solution, sorry, that is not an innovation. When we talk about innovation means it is cut and paste across several streams. It can be cut and paste between biology sciences and mechanical engineering, from mathematics and mechanical engineering, English and mechanical engineering. So everywhere you do a cut and paste and try to develop a solution. And for that solution, if you have a customer, then that becomes an innovative solution. What Government of India is pushing, what AICT is pushing, what TechUp is pushing is more towards innovative products. So for innovative products, it is not a difficult task at all. India is a country where there is so much of population, and India is a country where there are humpty number of problems still exist. As a student, as an engineer, your way of solving the problem is go identify a problem and then try to find out what can be the technological solution for that particular problem. Then that is it, you are innovation. So India is a country where you have humpty number of problems. We are multicultural, we are multilingual. So there are humpty number of problems which exist. So for all these problems, you will have few customers. What works very good in Tamil Nadu will not work very good in Nagpur, will not work very good in Uttar Pradesh, will not work very good in Jammu and Kashmir. Every place they need a customization because of its culture, because of its practice, because of its lingual, or because of its acceptance. So at every place, there has to be something called as mass tweaking. A technology which is developed, which has to be tweaked to meet out to customer requirements. So friends, the future is going to be these four words. You have to think, develop sustainable, socio, economic, and innovative products. And the future is going to lie only in this four. The future is not going to be high capital intensive industries. Now the government comes and says, or the business gurus, they say management gurus, they say the capital intensive equipments as of today should not cross more than 3 crores or 4 crores. That's all they say. So now when you talked about 3 crores and 4 crores as a capital intensive equipment, because the world is changing very fast. The product life cycle is going down very drastic. For every 3 months, you get a smartphone. For every 2 months, you get a new laptop. For every month, you try to get a shirt, which was earlier not possible at all. So look at it, because of all these changes which is happening, we are supposed to keep these four words in our mind. With that, let me get into. So earlier, we were trying to talk about, this is the figure which we always talk about. We used to talk about continuous process. Continuous process means a single discrete product or a continuous product which is repetitively produced. Then with this single product, small variation if it is there, and you repeatedly produce the same thing. For example, assume that you are a hotel running fellow and wherein which you try to make daily naan, paratha, sabji, and palak paneer and paneer butter masala. So regularly you make it. So you have made 6-7 varieties, and this varieties is repeated regularly without a change. So those things are called as repetitive products. When you run something like a middle level hotel, so then it becomes something like a batch production where the variety is large, numbers are not huge, but you try to produce it to meet out to the customer requirement. So those things are called as batch production. When the variety is large and the volume is too low, for example, take your own house. So we fall under job shop production. And where the variety is too large and the volume is too low, exclusively maybe during marriages, what you prepare. So those things are done here. These are all now available. Depending upon the production volume and depending upon the variety, you decide where do you fall, and then you plan your industry accordingly. But today, all these things are getting shifted. What we are trying to talk about is something called as mass customization, where the variety is very large and the volumes are also very large. We are talking about a concept called as mass customization. See, when you try to buy a shoe, you go to a Bata shop and then you try to measure your shoe size. If, let us assume you are fortunate, you fall a size between 7 and 8. So now the Bata shoe shop fellow will say, sir, you can either wear a 7 size shoe or wear an 8 size shoe. When you wear an 8 size shoe, the shoe is loose. When you wear a 7 size shoe, it is very tight. But friends, for which you have paid money. So now I pay money, but I don't get a product which is customized exclusively for me. That's what is the customization, what we talk about. And interestingly, when you are trying to buy a shoe also, we try to measure the length of the shoe, the length of your foot we measure. But unfortunately, the shoe is decided, the shoe, what you wear is decided by the mouth through which your leg enters. So when you look at the mouth depends on the width and the length of your foot. We never measure the width of your foot. We always measure only the length of your foot. Now you see, there is not much of customization. You have paid money. Assume that you have bought a Nike shoe, green color shoe, 5,000 rupees. The same size, your friend has also bought green shoe, 5,000 rupees, Nike shoe. So now you both are going for a temple. You park your shoes outside. And when you come back, the new shoes, you will not be able to distinguish which is your shoe, which is your friend's shoe for which you paid 5,000 rupees. So that is called as mass customization. So today the scenario is going to be, we will talk about products which are similar, but not the same. Today you get products which are same, but what tomorrow you will try to get is, you will try to get products which are similar. There is a difference between same and similar. Okay. So once you start getting into mass customization, so then what happens is, you are trying to have a batch size of one. When you start thinking of having a batch size of one, so then you should realize batch size of one, then you should realize what should be the machine, what should be the machining process, what should be the tooling, what should be the quality check, what should be the packaging style, what is the logistic control I have. Look at it, completely it changes. What was batch size for 1,000 and what is a batch size for one? Makes a huge paradigm shift. Huge paradigm shift. When you look at this mass production, so it is always kept economy of scale, and we optimize the setup and then we start producing things. When we talk about mass customization, you typically take a craftsman. A craftsman tries to produce a product depending upon the customer when he comes and says, I need a product of this, can you produce it? For example, Ganesh Chaturthi, you go to an artisan and say, get me a Ganesh of this proportionality or something like that. So then the craftsman starts making it to meet out your requirements, right? So that is mass customization. So we try to push mass production and the craft production, a concept together, which was produced and kept, which is produced on demand. Mixing those two concepts, what we talk is mass customization. So here I clearly distinguish what is the difference between mass production and mass customization. The goal is to deliver goods and services at prices low enough that nearly everyone can afford them. Mass customization is delivering affordable goods and services with enough variety of customization that nearly everyone finds exactly what they want. The economics is economics of sale. When you talk about mass customization, it is economics of scope and customer integration. The focus is going to be efficiency through stability and control. Here, the variety and customization through flexibility and responsiveness. So if you look at it in a similar way, we are going to talk about key features, stable demand. Here it is fragmented demand. So here it is a homogeneous market. It is a heterogeneous niche market. So niche is new. Low cost, consistent quality, standardized goods and services. Low cost, high quality, customized goods and services. Look at the difference. Look at the difference. There is something called as pull technology. There is something called as push technology. There is a big difference. Every day morning, preparing 50 samosas and keeping it in your plate and trying to sell it is called as push. Is called as push technology. In the beginning of the day, morning, you will start with 5 rupees a samosa. Maybe mid of the day, you make it 4 rupees. When come evening, you will make 3 rupees because then you cannot hold it for the next day. It becomes a stale product. So you'll have to discard it so that you make money. So this is push technique or push technology. What is pull technology? Daily morning, somebody comes and says, okay, I need to buy 50 samosas from you. Here is an order. So you start getting the order and start producing it. That is called as pull technology. Okay. So what we are trying to look at is pull technology. So low cost, high quality, customized goods and services. The product life development cycle should be as small, short as possible. So if that is the case, the product should follow modularity. What is modularity? Take your shirt. So in your shirt, you have two hands, you have a trunk, you have a collar, you have buttons, you have a pocket. So now assume that all these things are individually made and then finally it is assembled. So then it is called as modularity. So if you want to shorten your product development cycle time and reduce to short product life cycle, then you should follow the concept called as modularity. Modularity plays a very, very, very important role. Okay, so the customer involvement will be very high when you are trying to talk about the mass customization as against mass production. So earlier, what used to happen is we used to produce and then one way we used to just dump it on top of the customer. Today, it is not so. We are trying to back and forth. The industry is trying to talk to customer, understand what he wants. They then do some iterative change in the industry, try to produce it and then give. So now we are talking about interactive dialogues happening between customization. So what is that we are planning to do? Suppose today in Amazon, what happens? You just say, okay, here is a jockey. I have to buy a jockey XX, a double XL pant, which is for my jogging application. Okay, so now what do? I just go there, type jockey brand, and then I say double XL for maybe jogging, I put. So then what it shows only different colors there. So immediately what you do, you pick a color of your choice and then place an order in Amazon. That is not customization. That is just giving you a variety in color. Suppose if the same company says, jockey says, okay, so you have a pant. In the pant, do you like to have a bottom cuff which is there? Would you like to have a pocket which has a zipper? So zipper, should it be made out of plastic or metal? Okay, so all these things, they show in front of you. Then you pick, okay, do this, do that, do this, do that, do this. And then finally, it will show a design in front of you. You will have a freedom saying that, okay, front end of your pant, the front end of your pant can be blue in color, the back end can be gray in color. Why not? One leg can be red in color, one leg can be green in color. Why not? So it is now, what is that? It is mass customization. So the customer will be interactive. and there will be dialogues which is going on. And based on all your inputs you give, then it will be like a syntax error or not. So if it is feasible, then it will say, okay, this is the feasible and this is how it looks like, and these are the possible colors you will have. And if you want to now freeze, freeze. So now the product is developed with the dialogue which is happening between the customer and the industry. So this is what is going to happen in the near future. So for following it, there are several frameworks. So Cura is one framework which is more focused towards mass customization. So in mass customization product strategies, you will have Cura. Cura, the first thing is curation. So here we will try to remove all the unwanted choices. All the unwanted choices and make only the appropriate choice what a customer can pick from your product. Then usability, we try to develop a mechanism for elicitating choices. Resonance is resolve the real power, real product need for individualized customer with features that resonate. And anticipate is what you have, what you expect, and try to produce more. For example, let us assume I and you go to a hotel, and in that hotel, if there are bearers available, so then you say, okay, it's a good hotel, there are bearers. Next, if the bearers are all little educated and polite, then you feel, okay, it looks impressive. Now the bearers are well dressed, and then they are speaking good Hindi, they are very polite. And that's the second thing you'll see. Suppose if the same person is well-dressed, polite, as well as he tries to completely guide you through the menu card, then you feel, wow, what a beauty it is. Now, replace all the male bearers with a female bearer and they are properly dressed. It says, wow, all our female vendor, the suppliers or waitress, and they have a complete hold over the subject. That means to say the menu card, and they are very well dressed, they are very polite, and they are also guiding me through getting a menu card. So what happens is you will say, wow, a hotel is expected to have a waiter or a waitress, but if the waitress is giving more service, and if you see very closely, for the waitress or the waiter, you don't pay money at all. You pay for what you eat, and finally you tip him for the way he behaves. Right. So this is what is told as the unwanted means. So how to recommend resonating ideas that customers did not know they wanted. Okay. So Cura is one which is giving a framework to work towards mass customization. So the limits of mass customization, what puts a limitation of this mass customization? The limitation is going to be the highly flexible manufacturing system has to be there. So you should have a machine wherein which it can keep changing itself with respect to program. It should have reconfigurable machines. Say for example, by using this machine, I could make jalebi. The same machine, I just replace the dough and then make it as murku. Then I replace it and make something else. So now what is happening is I am trying to have maximum flexibility in the machine. And then it can be a CNC machine, it can be a milling machine, it can be an inspection machine, it can be a material handling machine. So all these machines put together fall in the flexible manufacturing system. So mass customization heavily demands flexible manufacturing system. It requires an elaborate system for eliciting the customer information. It requires strong direct to customer logistics systems. People not willing to pay to have everything customized. So these are some of the limitations why even today mass customization has not been followed in the industry. These are the restrictions. Because of these restrictions, you try to have you don't follow mass customization. So mass customization is very, very interesting. You would like to have a shirt only for yourself. You would like to wear a shoe only for yourself. In a sense, the designing of the shoe is done. You try to design your bag. You try to design your course content. You try to design your room. So if you see that these are all, what am I trying to do? I'm trying to customize it to meet out my requirements or my comfort. For doing all these things, we have to use the concept called as modularity. Today you have listened to the terminology called mass customization. Mass customization, and you have also listened to one more terminology, which is nothing but modular kitchen. We talk about modular kitchen. So modular kitchen is something which is very much talked about. So this modular kitchen, which we follow in our kitchen. So here, if you see, the space is very clearly identified, and you have frames, you have the shelves properly made for modular concept. Suppose if one is broken, you can quickly replace. Or if you wanted to compartmentalize your space, convert your 2D space into an effective 3D space, we follow modularity. In the same way, if you try to take a car, tires are modular, engine is modular, the steering is modular, the audio system is modular, bucket seat is modular, bonnet space is modular, running it by LPG or CNG modular. So all these things are different models. Depending upon your requirement, you keep tweaking. The AC unit, you want to make a powerful AC unit possible. Okay, so here I have put the different concepts of modularity. If this is followed in your product, definitely you will, and if you follow the four things, what I'm talking about, the sustainability, socio-economic and innovation. If you follow those, your product should have one of these modularity concepts. So components sharing modularity. For example, you will have a screw. You can have screws which you can have a Allen head. You can have a plus. You can have a negative sign head. So you can use any one of the screws or bolts for meeting all the requirements. Next is component sharing. So you can use multiple components for doing the same operation. That's called as component swapping. For example, I recently bought a watch for my wife. So wherein which the dial is one, and she had 12 different frames, or 12 different straps. So these straps are of multiple colors. You can try to choose which color strap you want to wear, matching to a sari. And in your sari, if you have multiple colors, so you can also choose the bottom side green and the top side white. So you can do a combination. So what you have done is you are swapping the straps to meet out the requirement. So those things are called as component swapping. Cut to fit model is you buy a jeans pant and then you find out it is lengthier than your height. So then what you do is you buy it and then give it to a tailor in the shop. He cuts it to fit and then you make it. So those things are called as cut to fit modularity. Mixed modularity is nothing but the concept which exists in the printer, basic color printer. So you have this mixed modularity. The next one is the bus modularity. It is almost the same like what is followed in the PCB. Bus modularity we follow. And the last one is sectional modularity. It is the highest level of modularity, where in which it is just like your software. So in your software, you can try to write a program and try to solve multiple questions, right? So it is just a software. On a software, whatever input you give, you write an algorithm and then you get the output. So those things are called as sectional modularity. Okay. So if you want to follow, if you want to have mass customization as your theme area, and if you want to follow the four key terminologies, whatever I said, so then you should always think of developing products which are modular. So when you are trying to develop products, these are the this is one of the most powerful tool which is used while developing products. So the technique is called as design thinking. There are five steps in design thinking. The first step is called as empathy study. You try to understand what is the problem faced by the customer, and then you undergo the difficulty what he is undergoing. So then what will happen is he will try to tell you what is the difficulty, and based upon the difficulty, he will try to sort out the issues. So empathy study is you trying to wear the shoe of a customer and staying there. For example, we did a small project work for Delhi police. So we were supposed to find out what is the daily collection of the beggar who is there in the New Delhi railway station. We all thought it will be 1,000 rupees. You might think it is 500 rupees. I might think it is 800 rupees. But finally, it was an amazing shock for us. Every beggar on an average makes 10,000 rupees a day. 10,000 rupees per day he makes. Then let us assume he works for 20 days. He works for 20 days. So he should be able to make 2 lakhs. So in a year, they should be able to make 24 lakhs. What happens to that money? What happens to that money? So when that question came, we were curious to know what happens to that money. So then we started looking into what really these people do. So they misuse their money. They lose their money, and somebody else steals from this fellow, one beggar, the other beggar steals. So all these things happen. So now, then what we did was, along with the Delhi police, because to reduce the crime rate, we were trying to work on multiple solutions, like shifting them to schools, sending them to skill development programs. So all these things we were trying to see, but many of the things failed. In fact, UNESCO came out with a scheme to help these kids, but they tried several tricks, but it did not work. In the same way, we were also trying to work very closely with an NGO close to Kanpur to help people to help power below the poverty line or the poverty line people, especially girls, from getting trade. So we wanted to start a scheme for them, and we wanted to protect them. We don't want to want them to run away from the house, lose the house, go missing. We don't want. So what we did was we picked these girls. We gave them training. We gave them training on beautician, this, that, and all. We gave them training. And after we gave them training, we said that, okay, you can work in this beauty parlor, and then you can make innings out of it. And we did it. So many girls started coming to our class, and after 1 or 2 days, they used to stop, or after 15 days, they used to stop. So the program was never successful. So then we spent a lot of time in understanding what is the problem. Why are these girls running away? It is basically the decision in the house is taken by male, and whoever is a male in the house, they have a very ill feeling about beauty parlor. So then we understood this problem, took all of them in a van, took them to multiple beauty parlors, and asked them to spend a day, asked them to get connected with the beautician there. And they kept asking questions. And then their whatever is their bad feeling about this beauty parlor was erased. And now this male, whom we took them around the city and showed them all the beauty parlor, they were impressed and convinced. Now the program is successful. So the entire thing, why I am trying to tell you the story, is until and unless you do an empathy study, you will not know what is the problem. Next, after doing this empathy study, the next one is the definition of the problem. When you look at any of the books, let it be your Applied Mechanics, Timoshenko, let it be your Strength of Materials, Shigle book, or Machine Design by Shigle, or let it be Sham series book, or let it be some hi-fi book. In all the academic books, you will see there will always be a problem statement. So the problem statement is either defined by the author or by somebody else. Now, what you do is you start identifying after getting to understand the problem, you have been taught an algorithm, you start working on the algorithm and start solving the problem and give the solution. And it is interesting to know, everybody in the class will try to give a unique solution. That means to say there will be only one solution. Everybody in the class who follows that methodology will get the same solution. But in reality, there is nothing called a unique solution. If that is true, everybody in this world will have a same cell phone. So what does it mean is there are multiple number of solutions for a single problem. So all you have to do is identify that single problem and start working on it, right? So the definition, what we talk about is somebody defines, but here you have to define. The definition, whatever you give, must have all the engineering terminologies and the engineering values to it. For example, I would like to develop a handkerchief, which has to be soft. So now soft is a parameter which is not quantified in engineering terminologies. You have to use an indirect scale to do it, but it does not, it's not so straightforward. So in the definition, what we do is we clearly state the problem. We clearly state the engineering units which can be done. Then on top of that definition, we try to develop ideas. We try to develop multiple ideas. So these multiple ideas are, for example, for one definition of the problem, we would expect the student to develop at least 25 different ideas. When I start developing these 25 different ideas, you will realize that it is very, very difficult to solve many of those problems. So first you develop a concept. Then from that concept, what you do is you try to develop a low fidelity prototype. Then you will go for a high fidelity prototype. And then you will try to show it to the customer. And then you start doing a testing cycle. Once you do your testing cycle, what next? Is the product going to go close to the market? No. You will realize whatever you have done till now is not perfect. So you will go back and do your empathy study more focused. So you will repeat this 3-4 times. And finally, what comes after the third time or the fourth time will be a market viable product, MVP. So with this MVP, you will try to go to the market. So you as engineer should follow a design thinking approach. Design thinking approach. Many a times you might see there are engineers who cannot even think out of their books. So if they cannot think out of their books, then how will they be able to solve the problems which is raised in the society? See, look at the way my wife is a school teacher. She is a school teacher for LKG students. So this year she has to do online class. Her customers are not known. The customers many of them don't know ABCD. She has to teach ABCD. The customers are from a multiple background. The school where she is working is not a high class school. So you will have people like Mali's son, Tekedar's son. You will have a professor's son. You will have a sweeper's son. So you see, socially, economically, there is a huge barrier or there is a huge difference. So you will have this spectrum of people attending the class, and she has not seen any of them. She has to get connected with them, and then she has to teach them ABC, where more than 50% of the students in her class are non-English speaking people. Or the child is the first education person who goes to school. The parents would have not even touched the school. So think of the condition like that. And there, my wife had to teach. And she has to give their attraction, and then she do. Every day, she innovates. Every day, she innovates. One day, she wears bangle all green in color. And she says, look at my bangle, how beautiful it is. Bangle is circular. From that circle, she says, okay, the alphabet O looks to be a circle. So look at the way she creates, and she goes, bangle is circular. So circular is a character, which is alphabet, which is O. Now she first introduces the character called O, or the alphabet called O, right? And next time what she does is she plays with the bangle, because she cannot take more than 7 minutes video. So she plays with her bangle. She makes a lot of music. And then what she says is, last class you studied O. Now what I will do is I will try to erase one segment of O and make it C. Now, if you ultimately ask a question, why is he teaching O? Why is he teaching C? Why should anybody teach ABCD continuous? Is any of your names continuously following ABCD? My name is Ramkumar. Ramkumar. Where is alphabet ABCD and where is my spelling? So it is not necessary that you should teach them in this fixed pattern. You are supposed to teach them your pattern recognition techniques. So that is important. So until and unless you do the empathy study, identify the problem, do this, do that, you will not be able to solve. If my wife would have typically gone like a teacher and said, this is yay, you should write it like this, the child will lose faith. Every day, the next day morning, the child waits for my wife's class because today my wife will go with a blue color bangle and she will tell some story. And she will go, she will make a small cartoon character and she will make that cartoon character act like a puppet. And then she will say, from this puppet, you see, you get a character called M. So you see how creative you have to be. So for doing all these things, you will have to follow this design thinking approach. So let me keep moving. So the other thing what you will all say is, sir, itna kaam karna hai to mere paas samay kaha hai. So for doing, for don't worry about time. Time management people say, it is very difficult for anybody to manage time, or it is not possible anybody to manage time. It is only possible to manage an event. You can manage an event, for every event there will be a time. So what we are trying to tell you is how to do time management, and you should start doing it. So what you do is, you every day morning at the beginning of the day, try to list down what are all the urgent jobs, what are all the not urgent jobs. You write it down. And then what you do is you segment them again, once again saying that what are all the important jobs, what is all non-important jobs. So you will have now four segments, which is urgent, important, not urgent, important, urgent, not important, not urgent and not important. Not urgent and not important, completely throw all these activities out. You can either ask somebody else to do it or you can do it at your own pace. Urgent and important are something which is burning, which you have to immediately solve. Every day, start putting this table. And when you do this, you do clustering of your events, what you are supposed to do. Then moment you do that clustering, then you will know how much time you can allocate for each event. And from here, you will realize that time management is something very important. For doing this innovation, time management is important. And we are trying to develop so many things. Okay. So here are two processes I would like to bring in front of you. So the first process is incremental forming. Incremental forming is a metal forming technique which is exhaustively used for sheet metal forming. Here we don't use die, we don't use sponge, but we try to use a forming tool where the tool end will be circular and it is a point contact. So now you keep a die or something else and just allow to move the form tool on top of this die. So, or you try to create a shape using the die, just like your machining, you try to create. So look at it. So without a die, without a punch, you are able to make profiles, or you are able to make sheet metal parts. So this process is called as incremental forming. And this is one of the most flexible process, which can, where the batch size can be thought of one. The next one is going to be rapid prototyping. Rapid prototyping, which was initially called about, will now, now the name has changed and people are started calling it as rapid manufacturing. In rapid manufacturing, what happens is people are trying to produce whatever is the part, not a prototype, but they try to finally make the part itself. When they try to make the part, this makes it much more interesting. And this makes the batch size as one. It is not one technique. There are several techniques under it. They are classified as beamless metal additive manufacturing and beam-based. When we talk about beam-based, it is electron beam, laser beam, okay, ion beam. When we talk about beamless, it is basically an adhesive is dropped and the adhesive joins the powder and then we take it for sintering process and we get the product done. So today, if you look at it, this is a conventional product. And what, after doing all this topology optimization and other things, we are trying to make products of this kind. The product shape completely changes. It is now able to work at a very high functionality. And we are trying to, the geometry is changed. And here we are trying to make lightweight, high strength, highly functional, multifunctional products to meet out to the requirements. So you look at it here, whatever was the core area which was filled by metal, now you have made a unit cell concept and you are trying to raster it and producing it inside. So this part will be light and it is multifunctional. So when we start, the conventionally, if you are using the 450 gram plastic part, now after doing this topology optimization in additive manufacturing, we have reduced the weight of the part to 180 grams. So the weight is reduced, the functionality is enhanced. So all these things are possible by metal printing. Okay. So this is what is the next important thing. So I'm just introducing two processes in front of you. One is incremental forming and rapid manufacturing. Here the batch size is one. Typically the batch size is one. Okay, so these are all more towards futuristic manufacturing. So when we talk about futuristic manufacturing, there is a large scale machining and micro machining. There are two divisions there. When we talk about micro machining, again, you have contact machining, non-contact machining, and you will have hybrid micro machinings. So why are these micro machinings very much used? Because we would like to have textures made on surface. The textures which are made on surface are going to give you a wettability property enhancement, a thermodynamic property, an optical property, surface coloring, cell adhesion, and the reducing of the tribology or enhancing tribological behavior. So for doing all these things, we are trying to do very small features. The feature size is less than 100 microns on a very large surface. So now large surface, what are we talking about? Our solar panels. So on a solar panel, if you make these textures, you are able to retain it for a longer, you are able to improve the efficiency. So where did we get this idea? We got this idea from Mother Nature. If you look at Mother Nature, if you see bitter gourd, they have made textures. Butterfly made textures. Organics made textures. So you can see tire, apple, all these things are concept and they are artificially made. They are all mimicked from this. Geometric, this thing which you can see on your on the lift stands and other things or the frames. So everywhere we are trying to use this this thing. So when we talk about machining of large area textures, we also copy the profile of a snake. So if you look at the snake, all the textures are oriented towards one direction. So now understanding this one direction and then trying to mimic the texture, we have made this laser texturing on top of polymer surface and metal surface. We are able to get the friction resistance as well as anti-friction resistance very fast. So these textures are copied from Mother Nature and we started using this for several of these applications. So today you will get shirts which you don't have to wash, hydrophobic repellent, you will have mobile phones. These concepts are stolen from the lotus leaf. So these are some of the machines which are contact machines which are available today for your understanding. So earlier we were only looking and then machining. Now we are trying to integrate like what sir was saying about deep learning, machine learning, and then artificial intelligence. Machining process, we will try to have multi-sensor approach. We will try to acquire the data, extract data, then convert it into vector methods, select, and then from there, we will try to figure out that when did the tool break and what is the tool response, what is the tool wear. So multi-sensor fusions will be integrated in these machines to meet out for those requirements. So when we look at laser, so here we have developed a textured pattern on a transparent sheet. You can see the finger there, but on top of the finger, we have made some textures. So this is used for strategic applications. This has been accepted by Indian Air Force. So when we talk about the other things, like these are the textures we made. And when we talk about this, laser, they can be used for, laser is also again a batch production, where a batch production can be one. They can be used for laser writing and they can also be used for projection technique, laser projection techniques. So when we talk about laser projection techniques, we will try to have a binary mask, we will try to have a grayscale mask, and we will try to have a phase shift mask. So you can see any kind of textures can be made, wonderful textures. Over a large area, we are talking about large areas, few millimeters, few centimeters. So I think I have covered majority what I wanted. These are all more in-depth studies. So I would just like to close it up and then ask for questions if there are any.
Yes, sir. Let me see in the chat box first.
Yeah. So these are all textures. These are all textures which are made for hydrophobic, hydrophilic surface for surface area enhancement. This is now used in batteries. You can see these are all the cathodes which are used. Okay. So you have so many techniques I have put because since I'm running short of time, I thought I will just skip it. So I am open for questions if there are any. So such small features can be machined today. And you can see large area, surface area is enhanced. Okay, so two photon polymerization. This was a machine which we developed here for varying applications. So then the last one is hybrid machining processes. So here we are trying to integrate two different processes, laser and turning, laser and drilling. So all these things. So these are some of the examples which we have done and then we can see. So laser for milling, laser for grinding, laser for inspection is also used. And laser is also used for electrochemical machining. So depending upon your requirement, the processes what I'm using here, laser, incremental forming, rapid prototyping, they all can be used for a batch size of one. So this was what sir was trying to cover, IoT and other things. So I would like to cover here and then come for questions if there are any. I would like to take questions for the interaction
session. I would ask participants if they have questions, they can unmute themselves and can ask questions. In chat box, sir, appreciations are only there.
No
questions. See, in chat box.
I want people to ask questions because yes, I have introduced a concept called as mass customization.
Yes, sir.
See, when people should realize when you fall sick, maybe you guys are 18 years old. When you fall sick, you go to a shop, get a paracetamol, 650, you 500 mg, you take. When your sister, she falls sick, 500 mg. When your mother falls sick, 500 mg. Father falls sick, 500 mg. Your brother falls sick, 500 mg. Now you see, immaterial of your body to mass index, immaterial of your sex, immaterial of your age, we all have the same tablet. So now it looks like there is something called as mass customization is not happening.
Yes.
Gone those days where a doctor used to first weigh you, measure your height, measure your weight, and then try to come out with the medication. Gone those days. So now we have to go back to the good old days where in which we talk about mass customization. Let it be medicine, let it be product, let it be even pen. The pen what you write, it is not customized for you. You might have a thick finger, you might have a thin finger, you might have sweating finger. So now the pen does not accept all these things. So that is what is mass customization. And you guys are going to enter into an era where it is all going to be mass customization. Yeah, so thank you very much. If there are questions, I'll be happy to take.
Yes, sir. Sir, good evening, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, my question is, as you said, mass customization increase many things. But, sir, there are lots of problems. Like, if we are customized something, like if we want to purchase a shoes, okay, it will be better if we tell everything about that we want. But it is difficult to create that environment, and that will be there will be more price.
See, gentlemen, what I'm trying to say is that is what I said, modularity will be followed. See, the sole, whatever you, for your shoe, whatever you want, there are only 6 or 7 different types of soles. If you see the design very closely, there are only 6 or 7 different types. And there are sizes which are different. So everything what you will see is it will be like a pull-down menu in a screen. You will choose this, you will choose this, you will choose this, you will choose this. Finally, if everything you attach, if it is feasible, it will say, yes, it is feasible. If it is not feasible, it will say, it is not feasible. We can't make it. Today, this technology is very much used in Europe and Japan.
Yes, sir. And sometimes it happens, like customer don't know how, like what he want. Like,
correct. So that's what the screen tells. The screen tells everything. So that's why I said the modularity concept has to be followed. See, आप टिक्की का दुकान जा रहे हैं, मैं तो गोलगप्पा खा रहा है. गोलगप्पा में क्या करते हैं वो लोग, he makes everything modular. And depending, you say that sir, और थोड़ा मिर्ची ऐड करो, then he puts 2 spoons. और ये मेरे को मिर्ची नहीं चाहिए, वो हटा दो. So then he removes it and he gives it to the customer. It is modularity, mass customization.
Yes, sir. So can we make such a different method?
You have to, sir, gentlemen, the era where you are, the era is for innovation, the era is for mass customization. You guys have to make. Can we make bhool jao, karna hi karna hai. Life aise hi chalega, boss.
Yes.
Okay, any other questions?
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
Dr. Tarun Sutta.
Yes.
I am thankful for your valuable lecture. Just I wanted to know, sir, you have mentioned about mass customization. And I think this is very useful for the customized products. But sir, how can we use it in the manufacturing? Because we have to create the different varieties, okay. And yes. We should yes. be able to allocate, and we should be able to segregate the different, like suppose if you are using the EDM, so we yes, should be yes. able to identify what all things can be done.
Correct.
And to what level. So there should be support from the company. There should be support.
Yes, sir.
So
yes.
There should be
yes.
some sort of standardization which should be
yes.
there.
Yes. See, what will happen is, sir, what will happen is, see, now currently what happens, the system of hotel, I will tell you, there is only two places in the Kanpur city where they boil rice. Rest of all the places, it will be distributed. So EDM machine, everybody will not hold an EDM machine. The company which holds an EDM machine, he will hold a spectrum of EDM machines, and he has enough of expertise. He will try to do as and when there is a requirement, he will get it done.
Yes, sir. Like there are, suppose if you go to buy or tires or I'm like, sir, there are some standard.
Yes. Things. Yes.
So like that, there should be some standardization. Correct, then only we can go for this modularity yes. and standardization.
Yeah. Every year on year,
the need
year.
Of the hour.
Yeah, year on year on year, the electronic product price goes down. Why is it going down? Because they have established a standard and they have said, everybody, please submit it to this standard so that you can make a product. So now standardization in electronics is, otherwise how can a cell phone price fall down? How can a laptop price keep on be falling down?
So that means that we can go for the customization, but
yes,
it
yes.
will be limited to that of that standardization.
Correct. See, sir, as of now, ye dur ki baat hai, but it will happen. It will happen someday. I am sure it will happen someday.
Sir, few years back, I had read that in Japan, there is a company which is hiring around 20 to 25 people, and it is providing the customized bicycles. So a person can choose what type of tire, what type of frame, and what
yes,
type
yes, yes.
of okay, they can available. Identify, and they are able to give it within a frame of 1 week or even less.
Yes.
So they are just having only 20 to 25 people they are having.
Yes. Yes, I agree, sir. Sir, it is happening. It will happen. Ye dur ki baat nahi hai, sir. First, the biggest revolution is integrating a bathroom into the house was a biggest revolution. We did it. And today you see that has got imbibed. So now you cannot see a house bathroom attached bedroom. You cannot see that nowadays. It has come to that level. So slowly, it will seep in and people will accept. It will go through.
Yes,
it will go through, right? And Gunesh Selvaraju. So he has asked a question, sir. What will happen to the standardization? Standardization. See, when you have to go for modularity, it is integrated. Standardization also will happen. Modularity, standardization, then comes modularity. How one will get the spare for a product? See, once you do modularity, you will get what happens to the after sales. It will exist. It will be use and throw. Abhi dekho, kafi sara PCB hai. If that is damaged, throw. Remote control. Earlier, I remember I used to repair on remotes. I know a shop in Kanpur where they used to repair remotes. Now you don't even find a shop where they do this remote repair. So things will evolve, things will go. So don't worry. Okay, so if there are no more questions, I would like to thank the organizer for giving. Sorry, I had to rush, but I had a lot of presentation. Through madam, I would only request if you can give me one more hour sometime later.
Yes, sir.
Yes, so I would like to go slow, and I would like to explain many concepts.
Yes,
today I had put only futuristic and mass customization. I had to tell you machines. I have to tell you design for your environment, all these things. So later, madam, it is not a hurry today, tomorrow. Later, maybe January, February, someday you give me one more hour. I will try to give more clarity in the same thing.
Yes, sir. So and we will, sir, we will hope for the best that this pandemic will soon get over and we would get opportunity to meet you personally at our institute.
Sure. Sure. Thank you so much, madam. And thank you for the opportunity. And I would like to thank Kodeji for giving such a wonderful platform. Thank you very much, sir. And the director also. Pandiji, thank you very much for your, for the Tyagiji. Sorry. Tyagiji, thank you very much for giving me an opportunity. I really appreciate. Thank you very much. And wish you good luck. And for all the participants, thank you very much for choosing it. It is only like a science fiction movie for you. But I have seeded a thought with you. Now you take this thought, start thinking. You sit back in your home. What you like, your brother will not like. Your mother will not like. Now, how are we going to customize for everybody? Think. Your mother does it in the kitchen. So think about it. So it is possible. Okay. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Professor Ramkumar, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah. I request Dr. Tarun Sutta, Head Mechanical Engineering, to propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you, madam. रास्ते कहाँ खत्म होते हैं जिंदगी के सफर में मंजिल तो वही है जहाँ ख्वाहिशें थम जाएं so it is my honor and privilege to express the vote of thanks on my own behalf and on behalf of the Department of Mechanical Engineering I hope and wish that this is not the end but the start of our journey in our quest for knowledge inspiring the future engineers to discover new opportunities to address the present and the future challenges facing the society and the world. In our quest for truth from the ignorance towards the brightness from the darkness towards the success from the failures, we have to move forward. And it is no big surprise that this world has identified that this land of this 1.3 billion people with 17% of the world population in just 2% of the world area has shown excellent resilience in this time of this COVID-19 pandemic. With the availability of least amount of resources, with the continuous and leading support from our Honorable Prime Minister, we have shown tremendous resilience and we have shown how to convert the challenges into opportunities. Even in providing the COVID vaccines to the world, India will be playing a key role to bring the world out of this COVID-19 crisis, dark tunnel, to the bright sunshine of light. At the start, I would like to acknowledge the blessing and guidance of our director, sir, Professor V.K. Tyagi, who has been an inspiring force to organize such webinars. Thank you very much, sir. I am especially thankful to our distinguished chief guest, Professor Khodke, sir, the chief project advisor, NPIU, the mentor and guide for us as a leading force behind such activities, for gracing the occasion, sparing his precious time from his busy schedule, for supporting our activity and allowing us this privilege. Thank you, sir. I am thankful to Dr. Anil Kumar, SPIU UP Project Administrator, for always encouraging and inspiring us, supporting us for organizing such events. I am also grateful to Professor J. Ramkumar, the distinguished and renowned speaker from IIT Kanpur, who has provided this opportunity for us to be able to listen to him. I have the honor of attending his lecture at IIT Kanpur twice, and I was willing to invite him, but nevertheless, we have been able to lesson from him. I am thankful to Dr. Mahaveer Singh, Nodal Officer, SPIU UP, convener event, for this continuous support and participation. I am thankful to Professor A.K. Nigam, our TQ coordinator, who has been kind enough to support us. I am thankful to Dr. Shahanaz Ayub, Dean R&D, webinar series coordinator, for the initiative taken towards organizing such an event. I am also thankful to all the faculty members and students from BIT and other institutes across UP and India for your valuable participation in making this event a success. Thanking you, thanks to all my faculty members from BIT Jhansi for the support towards organizing this event. Thank you, one and all.
I especially like to thank to Madam Shahanaz Ayub, who has been relentlessly on this series of webinars, and in a very rigorous and planned and structured manner, she has been conducting this webinar on every Saturday. So now we have to be made ourselves free for every Saturday, more particularly to her leader, Professor V.K. Tyagi ji, who has given her the free hand to organizing. And slowly it is moving towards my area, civil engineering, environmental engineering, and hydrology. So next few weeks, we can plan for that also. Thank you very much, madam.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Director, sir, would you like to quote something?
Yes.
Yes, sir, please, sir.
Anil Kumar, sir, I would like to ensure you that till the project duration, we will hold such activities on every Saturday.
Thank you very much, sir. Great, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, Dr. Tarun Sutta. Let me thank you, Dr. Mahaveer, also for your wonderful and tireless cooperation to this particular event. Yeah. So.